All right, you're still watching, you know, Checkpoint, and my name is Henry Sekanjako. And in the studio, of course, we rather, you know, program, we have his justice, Alphonse Winyidolo, and we're talking about the administration of justice in the courts of law. And before we took a break, of course, we said we'll be looking at corruption in the courts of law. And, of course, this is something that has been come up for a long time. Even your predecessor, Justice Bart Karolewe, talked about it, that is still a big issue. And of course, Ugandans watching us would want to know, what is your plan to fight corruption in these courts of law? Because people say that it's denying them justice. People are buying, you know, these cases, people are winning them because they are corrupting your officers.
Thank you for this. You see, it's one of those narratives we need to change. We need to approach this from a different paradigm. There must be a shift in our thinking. When we talk about corruption, what is corruption? Corruption goes beyond exchange of monies or other consideration. Corruption is a lot more involved. But other than just stop at blaming those few judicial officers who are corrupt, and by the way, there is a very small number. But of course, you need only one bad corrupt person to stain the name of an institution. In my vernacular, there is an adage which translates into English that one frog can spoil the water point. Just one frog can spoil the water point. You don't need a multiplicity of people to do something bad for it to have an impact, just one. But have you found a case? Would you like to report to me a case where a judicial officer sends out word that, okay, I'll make you win this case if you pay me $5 million? Have you ever heard of such a case? I have never heard. Almost invariably, the corruption you're blaming judicial officers for comes from you, comes from the people, comes from the public, either out of desperado or whatever it is, or in the knowledge that they have bad cases, but it comes from them. In one of his teachings, Jesus said the key prayer you should always cite to the Lord, what we call the Lord's Prayer, Our Father who art in heaven. There's that part which says, lead us not into temptation. They're asking God not to lead us into temptation. My message to the people is, lead the judicial officers not into temptation. Because that is where the genesis of corruption is. If you don't approach me, I don't think judicial officers have the courage to come and say, look, I can make you win. I don't know. It may be there, but I don't know. But of course, that's not to say a judicial officer who has been approached, who accepts to be compromised, should not be blamed. I do not, and no sane administrator of court can condone corruption. Because one thing that should never be bought is justice. It's like going to heaven. You cannot buy it. You cannot keep on giving money and doing the wrong things and you go to heaven. No. You buy going to heaven by doing the right thing by God's people. You do the things which God requires of you. We are Chief Justice of Uganda. It's because God has made the president appoint you. God has made the Judicial Service Commission pick on you. God has made Parliament approve of you. So when you are there in that position, you serve God's people. It is because they are God's people. If I was the only person on earth, I would never be a Chief Justice. I'm Chief Justice because there are people. I have to serve God's people. I cannot now adulterate that by taking money to deliver justice to somebody who should have lost, and I say, take it.
All right. Yes. Of course, Chief Justice, you're blaming Ugandans for promoting this corruption in courts of law. But then one would say that it's because of the poor payment of these judicial officers that there's corruption that we are seeing in these courts of law.
Yes. Everybody becomes a judicial officer knowing very well what the pay is. So I will not accept any judicial officer to say, oh, because my child was sick, I could not attend to the child, my pay is minimal, it is little. You took up the employment knowing very well what the pay is. You took up the employment knowing very well that once you are there, you are a prisoner by choice. You cannot now go out and do business. A judicial officer is not a merchant. For you, you've come to interview me. After here, if somebody finds you in a window market selling Irish potato, selling rice, there's nothing wrong. You get what I'm saying? But not a judicial officer. No. No way. You cannot even sit behind your wife's small joint where they sell sugar, they sell, you know, very decent things. You cannot. So let me help my madam. No. So you see, you choose, you come here knowing very well that it is a sacrifice.
Right. Of course, talking about corruption, we are seeing that some of your, you know, members on the bench have been indicted by foreign countries. Recently, the U.S. came out, you know, to issue sanctions, you know, against two judges in an adoption scam. What does this mean for the judiciary?
Well, two things, really. Of course, if there is some wrong committed by anyone, we investigate. As a matter of fact, we're investigating those accusations, by the way. Those allegations, we consider, we treat them as allegations. Allegations have been made against these judicial officers, one of whom has since left judicial service, one is still an active judicial officer. We have an institution, I don't have to name it, investigating whether there's truth in that or not. The part I don't understand is the condemnation, not only an allegation, but the condemnation by a foreign power that these people are guilty, these people are found to have done wrong, when, according to their own statements which they issued, nobody gave them a hearing. The right to be heard is fundamental, it's cardinal. It can never be compromised, the world over. Even the most brutal, the most undemocratic society still have that semblance of saying, we have this against you, what have you got to say?
Because, and we understand there are investigations going on. Regarding this case, how far have you gone? Is there a report that has been issued already?
Investigations are going on. It's not being done by the judiciary, but investigations are going on.
How far? Are we near completion?
No. They are going on. Serious investigations.
What are we like to see in case they are complete?
How would I know? I don't want to speculate.
But of course, you can say that maybe they will be punished for,
why,
in case they have been found guilty.
How would they punish them if it is found that all these allegations are false, for example, if it is found? So I think other than trying to preempt, to predict, or to speculate, let's leave the process to go on undisturbed. Mm-hmm. Without saying it has gone quarter distance, it has gone three quarters distance, they have got no evidence, they have got strong evidence, what is the point? It will come out in the open.
Right. Yes. Of course, Chief Justice, of course, we know that, you know, before you reached where you are today, you were a member of parliament at some point. And, you know, you played a key role in, you know, legislation passing certain laws. Is there anything that you regret, you know, having done as a member of parliament?
As a member of parliament, none. But as a member of the Constituent Assembly, now, with the benefit of hindsight, I mentioned it to some people yesterday. Provisions like the term limit should have been entrenched. That one, if you want to use the word regret, I regret because I was a member of the Constituent Assembly. Because the popular will of the people was, according to Justice Odoke's commission, which did the consultative work and came up with a draft constitution, that there should be term limit. And I think term limit is good. But it should have been entrenched. What do I mean? It should have been more difficult for Parliament to amend. Meaning if Parliament wanted it amended, they would start the process, then they would send it to the people to determine in a referendum whether this should be amended or not. for some reason we didn't think we should entrench it, and I think that's one of the mistakes we made.
Because Parliament has the mandate to amend the constitution. Yes. Is it something that you think you would advise that maybe they should reinstate these term limits?
No, actually Parliament made an attempt to reinstate it in the amendment that lifted the age limit. But this would have made it some form of omnibus amendment. They did it, but it failed on legal and technical grounds. It doesn't stop them from raising it and restoring it or reinstating it. But the popular will is that term limits should come back. That's why Parliament did that, but they did it wrongly. There was the Nandala Mafabi motion.
You think we should, you know, maybe they should have gone to the...
My personal view is term limits should be restored. When you read my judgment, the age limit judgment, I was very clear about my views about that. I dwelt on it for a very long time. If you read my judgment, so many pages on the issue of term limit. I even made an attempt to look for somewhere in the law where it could be justified the restoration. There was no way, and I would have been acting unlawfully to accept that it had been restored. But it's a popular thing that it should be restored.
Is this something that should concern us as a country, or?
It already concerns us, shouldn't. It's not just should, it's already concerning us. That's why Parliament pronounced itself that the previous Parliament made a mistake to lift it. The popular will of the people of this country is that it should be restored. But of course, that is the purview of Parliament, not for the judiciary. If they do it, and they do it in accordance with the law, and it is challenged, we'll pronounce ourselves. If they do it, but do it wrongly, not in accordance with the law, again, we'll pronounce ourselves and say so.
Someone will say that even though, you know, the presidential age limit is also important, that maybe should end up being lifted.
You're asking my personal view? My personal view is that the 1995 Constitution is so young that it should have been left to be nurtured. It should have been left to grow without a single amendment, except the amendment which the Constitution itself says after 5 years, the people should revisit and either amend or not amend. That is the movement or the type of form of government we should have. Because you see, a child grows from birth, learns to sit, learns to crawl, learns to run around the house, learns to speak and whatever, and becomes you and me, and competes in the Olympics. We must ask, do you change that child so that, do you make the child now begin running an Olympic at the age of 10? No. Even the famous Bolt could not compete when he was about 17. I think he was the last in some race. So the constitution of Uganda, like other constitution, and this is a very good constitution, by the way. I'm not saying because I was one of the framers, but in reality, if you find somebody who's sober-minded, somebody who's not biased, they will tell you this constitution is a good constitution. But I think these rather worrying amendments should be abandoned.
Right.
Yes. And the best example for that is only about, was it 10 years or so, they amended the term limit. And now, Parliament, everybody, you and me, we are clamoring that it should not have been lifted, it should be put back. That's the best example, that we should not touch the Constitution. If we are going to touch the Constitution, it should be positive amendment. What do I mean by positive amendment? The type which will strengthen the Constitution. Like, we had to decide in the year 2000 whether we want to continue with the movement, all-inclusive, or we were going pluralistic. And the people said, want to go pluralistic, the reintroduction of multipartism. That was positive. You get it? Yes.
Okay, Chief Justice, there's a new trend, you know, in the judicial of appreciating the best performing judges. And of course, there's worry that most of the judges, you know, are likely to perform to the gallery. And don't you think this is going to affect their kind of performance or what?
Well, the issue best performing judges is how some individuals or some institutions have assessed these judges. If you're talking about these scorecards, yes. But there are many judges who are so good and they're not named, because your criteria for saying a good judge may not be mine. Your criteria could be, oh, in 6 months, this one wrote 50 judgments. In 6 months, this one wrote 10. So the one who wrote 50 judgments is a better judge than the one who wrote 10. I gave the example of a medical doctor. First of all, the type of cases you handle might be different. And out of these 60, 40 might be applications, which you sit in court and write and dispose of. And the person who wrote 10 might have written on very complicated and come up with decisions that endure the test of time. So you know, it's not as simplistic as at times this put. We are not a court of statistics. We are a court of justice. Somebody may finish 5 cases, but the justice he has done outweighs somebody who has done 60 cases. But of course, that does not mean you should just handle 5 cases where you should be handling 20. No. There's a region where you say, look, 20, maybe 40 or something is super, but 20 is the reasonable. So that when you're only 10, we ask the question, but why only 10? What type of cases did you handle to make only 10? And you may find you handle cases which are more or less similar to the one where somebody delivered 50. Then we can ask certain questions.
So you're thinking
that... So it's not a simplistic thing, yeah.
Do you think in a way to improve performance of these judges, that because you know, those that are performing well are appreciated after all?
I am a judge myself. I think what improves the performance of a judge, the first is, what does the appellate court say about your judgment? Because that is how we mark our scripts. When I'm a trial judge, I come out with my judgment, somebody appeals, it goes to the court of appeal. What do they say? Because they'll pronounce themselves, that's where we rebuke ourselves. The court of appeal will rebuke the lower court judgment and point out this should have been like this, or they will agree with the judgment and say this is well written. Then you also know. The second one is, when your judgment is cited by practicing lawyers as an authority in court, that, oh, this type of thing, the decision of so and so is there, and then you know. But this one of saying scorecard, I'm not against it, but we need to be careful. Really, really, what are the considerations? What goes into saying you are a better judge than the other one?
What are your fears? What are your fears?
No, it is not fears. I'm just being reasonable. Why should I fear? I mean, why should I fear? But you see, the thing is, what is your criterion, or what are your criteria for saying this is excelling, this is not excelling?
Okay, I will take you to a ruling that, you know, was made by one of your justices, Justice Lydia Mugambe, you know, asking the Electoral Commission to allow prisoners and then people in the diaspora to vote. But apparently it's like, this is not ready for this. Don't you think this is in a way going to affect, you know, Ugandans in prison and the diaspora? You know, it's going to deny them a chance to vote.
Well, I don't have the facts of the case before me, and I don't know whether it is not on appeal. So it is on appeal, it's not safe, it is not proper to discuss. But the point is, the judge came to a decision based on the facts before her and looking at the law. The judge can be right, the judge can be wrong. If somebody is aggrieved, come to the appellate court, where 3 justices will review that decision. Yes, yes. I also know that, was it 201? I think 201. Kizza Besigye was nominated from prison. So we always try to say, look, is there something, what is the letter and spirit of the law? Does it permit this? So if in the view of the judge it permits that, then let's hear what the appellate court will say if it is on appeal. Yes. If they agree with her, that's the position. If they don't, yes. But of course, the Electoral Commission must come up with the machinery for that type of voting. Yes. Because the judge will decide, the Electoral Commission will not say, okay, the judge has decided, so diaspora, you do like this. It involves a lot of things. You need safeguards and so on.
You think it can lead to rigging of votes? It's not...
I don't know. You know, every electoral process must have safeguards because people are capable of doing anything. Yes.
Parliament recently passed the administration of the judiciary bill. And of course, there are fears that...
The act.
It's an act because the president's already assented to it. There's fear that, okay, people are saying that it's not fair, you know, for government to pay a sitting judge the same money that they're paying to one that's retired. What is your take on this?
Well, it is not the same. It is only the Chief Justice and the Deputy Chief Justice who retire with their salary and other allowances. Let me tell you, we're just doing it in Uganda today. Other countries of the world have done it for years. And not just outside, within the region. For them, when we were not doing it, they say, what's wrong with you? You know why? To be a judicial officer. You look at judicial officers who have retired. We're all sickly, out of this work, sedentary life, before the computer and auto-recording of evidence. We were doing stenography as I'm listening to evidence. So you find by the time I retire, my shoulders are in a mess. So, and after you've retired, again to begin running around, either in a law firm or looking for a job because you have to maintain your family. That dignity goes. You were a senior judge of the Supreme Court, you ran to a magistrate's court, and you're fighting with some very junior people. No, so it is only fair that the person who accepts the self-imposed imprisonment serves his or her country, retires, and does not go to look for a job, goes home. You can be now a consultant. You can now do mediation for people. You can now help society without having to ask society that pay me, because now the state is paying you to be useful to the society you're retiring to. So I don't think it is asking too much, because think of the person I attended class with. Went and did medicine. I went and did law. We were both the cream of our, I was the cream of the arts, and that person, he or she, was the cream of the science, so goes for medicine. He's now a consultant, but he appears in 3-4 medical centers in a day, earns from 3-4 medical centers in a day. You get what I'm saying? Or even if it was not 3-4, even if it is one, you work in a government outfit, in the evening, you need just to do 2 hours only. In the evening, you go to your medical center. Now, a judge cannot do that. A judge cannot go to a supermarket and sit behind a desk and do management or do sales. Because you cannot be both a judge and then you go and brush shoulders with people like that. A medical doctor will do it. A lawyer out in private practice will do it. An engineer will do it. And these are professionals. So the life of a judge is slightly different.
Don't you think this is going to have an impact on the resource envelope of the country?
Yeah, but if it will make the people of Uganda enjoy justice, if it will make the judges, because the stakes are going to be very high, it will fight the corruption you're talking about. Now you are paid, you retire, you continue to be paid. You think how many people would want to risk that benefit to accept money from somebody, however much that money is. You get it? So there's the positive, apart from securing the judge who puts so much sacrifice, it raises the stakes. The bar is very high. You know that you could be sacked tomorrow and that's your end. You could work, suffer with whatever you're given as salary and allowance, and when you retire at either 65 or 75 or 60, when you retire, you know that there is continuity. You are a happy person. It's not about wealth, but you can look after yourself. You can look after your children.
Do you think this same arrangement should be extended to other junior judicial officers? Because for them, they earn very little money, but you guys who are earning loads and loads of millions of money are going away with that, you know, big package.
You see, the thing is, we were also junior like them. Do you get it? We were junior.
So they should work hard for it?
Yes, it's actually, it should be an impetus. Say, look, if I work hard, if I deliver, if I perform, I will be there. Yes, but because judicial officers cannot be seen to be doing something else, whatever remuneration they get should be more reasonable than what they get. That one I agree with you. But they cannot be paid the same with me, because how long did it take me as a lawyer to become Chief Justice? I became a lawyer in 1984.
So you've worked for it, yes, to be where you are right today?
Over 30 years, no? Over 30 years. So why should somebody come from university, work for 5 years, and think the considerations I'm given should be given to him or her? We must learn to work. We must learn to earn the things we get. Actually, this thing of remuneration is a small thing. and people have not looked at. One, this act gives the judiciary the independence the Constitution provides. For many years, we are just considered a department in the Ministry of Justice. This act now clearly brings out we are independent. We now take charge of our budgeting. We sit down, we've started the process, for example, we sit down and say, what do we need as the judiciary? We prepare our budget proposals. I present it as Chief Justice to the President. The President will take it and not even change a punctuation. He will not change a comma. He will get his team and they'll make their own remarks on each of the items which we have asked for, which we have sought to be provided for in the next financial year. Then he presents the budgetary proposal which I presented to him to Parliament, which has got the right to appropriate. With these comments, Parliament will look at our proposal, look at the comments from the President, and either agree with us or agree with the President or somewhere in the middle. Now, that one was not possible when we were just a department.
How was it before? How was it before? Maybe you can take us through.
No, it was that you prepare with finance as part of the budget for under the Ministry of Justice. The policy statement is presented by the Minister of Justice. It may still be there, the policy statement, yes, because there's got to be a line ministry. It may be there. But the actual planning for the judiciary is now in our hands.
Yes. Congrats on that. Of course, our time is first spent, Chief Justice. And of course, before we bring this to an end, we want to know, you know, any message from you to Ugandans as we head to the 2021 elections.
On the 2021 elections, yes, I've said it earlier, elections are not a matter of life or death, or life and death, no. Election is about getting one of the so many capable people to come and represent you in Parliament, or getting one out of the so many to be the president of the country with the heavy responsibility the Constitution gives the president. Very heavy. So it's not a matter of, it's not something you should shed blood about, it's not something you should distribute sugar or salt or pieces of soap for. It's You need not commit any crime. You need not manipulate our people to become a member of parliament, to be the president. No, you need not. So our people should know members of parliament is a link between them and the rest of Uganda. Just that. And we waste so much taxpayers' money, which we could use elsewhere in election petitions. Yes. So we can avoid all that.
Away from elections, many people have lost trust in the judiciary. What is your last, you know, word to them?
I need to know why they've lost trust. Why have they lost trust? Because every day, the courts are inundated by cases. I have a backlog of over 30,000. The one who told me, if there was loss of trust, there would be no cases being filed in court. Yes. You cannot say, you have no trust in me, and then you run to me to keep your money. It doesn't make sense.
All right. Okay.
What I think you want to say is, people expect better from the judiciary. Better justice delivery from the judiciary. I agree. But I think I answered that. I say the judiciary, we are willing. I have a competent team in the judiciary. The issue is not anymore, and we need to change this narrative. If they want to lose confidence, they should lose confidence in the executive or in parliament for not giving them a robust judiciary.
Right.
Yes. Okay. If the spear I used to fight, I must get it from you, and you are not giving me, who is to blame? Is it me or you? It is you. So let the executive and parliament give the people of Uganda, not to the judiciary, not to the chief justice, 150 judges. Give to the people of Uganda double the number of magistrates. Fill all the slots of magistrates and grade ones which are available. Then you come back to me after 6 months and say, yeah, it was done 6 months ago. What have you got to say? I'll tell you what you want to hear.
Okay, you heard it from the Chief Justice. Thanks so very much for joining us. Our time is done, and we thank you for sparing time to be with us on Checkpoint. We'll check you again next time. That's it from our desk, Checkpoint, and we ask you to keep it up, but good night for now.